We are separated from the ancient archers of the Stone Age by an almost unimaginably vast gulf of time, but there are still lessons that we can draw from the traces that they left behind. We don't just have artifacts. We also have many visual records of their wars, their hunts, and the animals around which they based their lives. Stone Age artwork could have been used for worship or prayer. It could also have been used in a ritualistic fashion to help tell tales about legendary hunts. Or some of it could have been very individualistic and personal creations. Regardless of the reason, here are what I think are some important observations about the ways in which the bow and arrow was an integral part of our ancestors' lives and deaths. In order to tell this story properly, first it is important to recognize what archery was not used for. Mammoths and other large megafauna played a critical role in the expansion and survival of the human species early in our history, but both our hunting of mammoths and their eventual decline long predate the first signs of archery in the visual and archaeological record. In the vast hindsight that the millennia can offer us, this is an entirely logical situation. Though silent and accurate, arrows are not the ideal tools for downing extremely large game such as mammoths. Higher energy projectiles, such as the spears launched from an atlatl, or spear thrower, are considerably more capable. Due to their higher mass and their method of propulsion, atlatl darts provide superior penetration against large, thick targets. And indeed, the physical evidence for atlatls and large projectile points directly correlate to the time frame for mammoth hunting. Additionally, more recent historical methods of hunting similar large game, such as elephants, also strongly favor the use of high-mass weapons, such as these 19th and 20th century African tribesmen taking down elephants with hand-thrown spears. So why and when did the atlatl and spear become phased out in favor of the bow and arrow? It is generally accepted that some combination of hunting pressure and climate change caused the extinction or migration of a large number of megafauna species all across the world. For example, the mammoths that did survive retreated to the tundra in higher latitudes, while their former territory was overwhelmed by the regrowth of the forests. Spears and spear throwers could certainly be adapted for use against the prey that dwelled in the new habitats, such as red deer, and reindeer could still be hunted with spear throwers, just as they had been before. But a bow and arrow could be used with far greater accuracy and stealth. These were skills which were now of paramount importance, far more than they had ever been against the mammoth. Conveniently, the same climate change that helped to drive the mammoth's extinction appears to have also allowed species such as yew, elm, and Scotch pine to gradually repopulate the areas once dominated by tundra. People were now able to take greater advantage of these woods to craft deadly bows and arrows, in some cases importing them far from their source of growth. It is possible that bows existed earlier in limited numbers, perhaps manufactured from spruce, but now they were ascendant. The retreat of megafauna, the resurgence of the forests, and the shifted focus to smaller, more agile prey. This is a convergence of interrelated phenomena that all take place at approximately the same time, 10 to 12,000 years ago, and that is when the first definitive evidence of archery emerges. As human beings inevitably committed towards the bow as their principal weapon, techniques had to be developed to use it effectively. What is rather striking is that the earliest methods that are represented in cave art are still in use today by modern hunter-gatherers. The ubiquitous yet highly similar nature of these methods, even in the 21st century, by peoples who have been separated from each other for thousands of years, strongly supports the notion that they are among the most ancient and the most effective. For example, historical bow hunting, just like spear hunting before it, was not an individual activity. It was a group exercise, with the future of the community at stake. Cave art depicts multiple hunters working as a team, swarming a large beast and overwhelming it with projectiles from every direction, wounding it, wearing it down, until it eventually succumbs. Additionally, some of the very basic methods of carrying and shooting the bow and arrow appear to have remained relatively unchanged over time. Cave art, particularly from eastern Spain, depicts hunters traveling and shooting with arrows held in the same hand as the bow. This is a very convenient, efficient, and streamlined method, and is still observed today in Brazil, Papua New Guinea, and Africa. Note that the orientation of the arrow points and fletchings is also unchanged. Having the points oriented towards the top end of the bow is a common sense safety practice, especially during travel. One drawing might also represent a rare method of carrying arrows between the thumb and palm of the draw hand. This has been observed in use in both ancient and modern Africa, and also in scattered places in the Americas. As the success of the human race was fueled by its efficient hunting tactics, so too did humans come into conflict with one another. Competition for resources and territory inevitably led to violence, and for this, the bow and arrow was also a prolific tool in early human history. Combat scenes depicted in Spanish cave art are remarkable for the fact that they show two large, well-armed groups engaging one another. Some authors have noted that this might be reflective of ritualized warfare, with rules and terms of engagement. If one group truly wanted to eliminate the other one, the logical course of action would be to ambush them in their home territory, kill all the men, and kidnap the women. Meeting them on equal terms only really makes sense if it is a prearranged meeting. Ritualized combat like this might seem impractical to us nowadays, but it is surprisingly common in some parts of the world. For example, there are clashes between the Maasai and other tribes in Kenya, and the battles fought by the Dani tribes in Papua New Guinea also have much in common. Formalized warfare like this is almost religious in nature, a never-ending cycle of revenge and retaliation. The enemy tribe is a ways of uniting your own people, of finding a common purpose and defining an identity, honoring one's ancestors, and seeking out plunder. It all speaks to a surprising behavioral complexity of early humans, and of a surprising longevity of our material and cultural practices. Much like the bow and arrow itself, once humans find a process or a practice that works, they have a tendency to stick with it for a long period of time, only gradually improving it here and there unless something truly revolutionary is invented. The Stone Age was doubtless a very difficult time in which to live, but the evidence for ancient archery indicates that people were very clever and resourceful, and it is thanks to their ingenuity and persistence that we are alive today, and that we can peacefully appreciate the legacy of the bow and arrow that they have bestowed upon us.